Trapping in the early part of the last century would have been a tough life, and for the trappers of Rat River, a solitary newcomer was making things a lot harder. The reclusive stranger entered the northern Canada region in 1931, displaying a lot of cash, but with few words. He rapidly built himself a small bush cabin on Rat River in the midst of prime trapping land. Soon after his arrival, other trappers were discovering that their own efforts were being sabotaged. They realized that the stranger was setting off and displacing their traps to improve his chances of success. The trappers complained to the local Royal Mounted Canadian Police, who confirmed that the unknown interloper had failed to apply for a trapping license. On New Year's Eve 1931, Constable Alfred King and Special Constable Joe Bernard trekked the 60 miles to the stranger's abode to have a word. Seeing smoke coming from the cabin chimney, the constable stood outside in the minus 40 degrees weather, trying to engage with the stranger, who they could see was inside. The latter described the man as clean-shaven, short, muscular, and holding the gun tight in his hand. As they peered through the window, he placed a sack over it. Convinced that the stranger would not hesitate to target them, the constables returned to Aklavik to obtain a search warrant and get backup. King and Bernard soon returned with three additional men and the warrant. Once again, the stranger, who rarely uttered a word but was believed to speak with a Scandinavian accent, refused to open the door for them, and so King decided to force it open. However, before he could start, the stranger discharged his shot through the door, hitting King. The other police pulled their weapons and delivered a volley on the cabin, but still the stranger refused to cooperate. Concerned for their wounded colleague, the constables headed back to Aklavik, where King recovered. On January the 4th, 1932, the authorities made their way back to the stranger's cabin. This time, they were 9 in number, and they brought the assistance of 42 dogs as well as 20 pounds of dynamite. They decided to forgo the formalities and instead hurl some of the dynamite through a window, then took cover. When the dynamite exploded, the cabin collapsed, and the police posse, convinced that the stranger must have perished, nevertheless approached the wreck with caution. As they closed in, to their shock, the stranger stood up unharmed from his 5-foot-deep dugout and with a gun in each hand. For 15 hours, he and the police exchanged gunfire until, for the third time, the stranger managed to repel the lawmen, who were now completely convinced of his ruthless resilience. Reports of the stranger's standoff with the Royal Canadian Mounted Police were spreading throughout the country, with radio stations dubbing him the Mad Trapper of Rat River. On their return to the destroyed cabin on January the 14th, the police found that the Mad Trapper had left the area. For 2 weeks, they tracked the fugitive trapper as he headed further north. With no protective shelter, the temperature dropping to minus 50 degrees and confronting 2 blizzards, the Mad Trapper had to keep moving. When the police finally caught up to him, the tough character was ready for them. The Mad Trapper opened fire, hitting Constable Edgar Millen in the heart before scaling up a sheer cliff, his taunting laughter clearly heard. Every step of the way, the cunning bushman had the upper hand on the police, but it became increasingly difficult for him to evade the ever-growing posse. After the slaying of Constable Millen, its ranks swelled to over 100 men, including members of the Inuvialuit tribe and Gwich'in tribes, whose knowledge of the country helped police. The Mad Trapper seemed to be moving twice as fast as a posse, even though they wore snowshoes and he didn't. He was also cunning. He would backtrack, retracing his own steps, so as to leave snowprints which created 2 paths for the posse to follow. He also stayed very quiet, knowing that if he shot an animal for food, the sound would carry for miles, while the light of a fire would also be a sure giveaway of his location. The Mad Trapper ingeniously constructed temporary shelters in snowdrifts, which he collapsed before leaving. The police believed that the Mad Trapper was heading for the Yukon and decided that their best chance of catching him lay in blocking the only 2 paths in the area. Never one for an easy option, the Mad Trapper climbed a 7,000-foot mountain in blizzard conditions to avoid the stakeouts. It wasn't until a pilot called the police, reporting to have seen footprints at the top of the mountain, that they realized their quarry had evaded them. Wilfred Reed May, who had been nicknamed Wop by his two-year-old cousin, who couldn't pronounce his name properly. Born in Manitoba, by the time May joined the Royal Flying Corps during World War I, he was known to all as Wop. By the end of that conflict, he had been promoted to captain and also awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross. Most famous was his part in the demise of the notorious Red Baron. While Wop was not directly involved, it was his battle with the Red Baron's cousin that finally resulted in the Red Baron's downfall. Post-war, the ace aviator opened Canada's first airfield and established May Aeroplanes Limited with his brother. In 1924, Wop lost sight in one eye after it was hit by a shard of steel in an accident. However, he refused to stop flying and was already a Canadian hero. And not just for his war service, it helped in the apprehension of killer John Larson and also made a life-saving flight to Little Red River, Alberta, where he delivered the medication they needed to fight a diphtheria outbreak. The newspapers had called Wop's journey the race against death. A month into the manhunt for the Mad Trapper, the police were no closer to catching him, and their chances of doing so were probably getting lower by the day. Since the Mad Trapper had successfully made it into the Yukon, there'd be no clues as to where he was. Out of desperation, the police hired Wop to use his plane to thoroughly survey the area. Wop and his ski-equipped Belanca monoplane joined the manhunt on February the 5th and for over a week flew over the Yukon searching for any clue as to the whereabouts of the Mad Trapper. On February the 14th, Wop found the first indication of the killer's presence that anyone had seen in weeks. He noticed a set of footprints along the frozen surface of the Eagle River. The Mad Trapper had been following caribou tracks to speed his progress and hide his own trace. Caribou walk in the middle of frozen rivers to gain better visibility of approaching predators. Walking in their tracks had hidden the man's footprints and enabled him to travel quickly on the compacted snow, without the slowing effect of using snowshoes. 2 days after Wop's observation, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police finally caught up with the Mad Trapper. They spotted the man as he rounded a bend in the Eagle River. The fugitive was standing there, almost as if he was waiting for the police's arrival. A firefight broke out, wherein the Mad Tracker was massively outnumbered. He tried to flee, but without being able to follow the caribou tracks, the snow slowed down its progress too much. He managed to plug one of the constables before the team took him down with a shot in the pelvis. Wop landed his plane and speedily transported the injured constable to the nearest airport. The Mad Trapper was left to expire on the riverbank. When the police searched him, they found in his possession over $2,000 in American and Canadian currency. That's nearly $40,000 today. They also found several gold rocks, a compass, knife and razor, some fish hooks, a few nails, hunted squirrel and bird bodies, laxative pills and teeth with gold fillings that seemed to have come from his own mouth. The police fastened the man's body to a sled and commenced their 150-mile trek back to Aklavik. There, photos of the stranger were taken and dispatched across Canada and the United States in the hope of finding out the man's identity. Over the years, multiple possible relatives of the Mad Trapper have come forward with reports of missing family members who match his description. Repeated DNA tests have been undertaken, with even in 2009 a televised exhumation of the man's remains taking place. However, all testing has come up with 100% negative, and it has only been determined that it was not Canadian, but probably grew up in either the Corn Belt of Midwest America or perhaps Scandinavia. The astonishing conclusion is that to this day, his identity still remains a mystery.